Hello and welcome to the Wellbeing College. Our aim at the college is to help you learn how to best take care of your mental wellbeing. We do that by providing learning opportunities where people can come together and explore resilience and positive mental health in the Scottish Borders. My name is Annette Murray, one of the personal tutors at the college, and today I'm going to take you through a course we have developed called Mental Health Awareness. You can find out more about this and other courses at the college on our website, www.wellbeingcollege.org.uk. You can also make an appointment with a personal tutor to better understand how the college can help you. If this is something you think might benefit you, please get in touch. Our website should have all the information you need about the college, who we are, what we do, and how we can help you. But if you have any more questions, please call us or send us an email. In today's course, we're going to take a general look at the topic of mental health. The purpose of the course is to understand what mental health is and that it's something that affects us all. Recognise the signs of poor mental health. Consider the impact of stigma and discrimination surrounding mental health. Appreciate why recovery is central to any discussion of mental health. And think about how we can look after our mental health and also support the mental health of others. This is a general introduction to some key ideas which you may find helpful and wish to think about some more. Sources of further information will be provided at the end of the course if you wish to explore these ideas further. Before we start, here's what you will need for this course: a pen or pencil and paper, or your favourite notebook for the activities. Whenever you see the pen symbol, it's time for you to do a short exercise. So listen to the instructions, pause the video for as long as you need to, and then hit play when you're ready to start again. Writing things down by hand can help us understand and remember ideas and makes it more likely that we achieve our goals, so I encourage you to do this. You won't be asked to share what you write with anyone, you're just doing it for you to get your thoughts down on paper. You also may want to eliminate distractions for the next hour or so. So if you can, switch off the TV and your phone. Put on headphones if that helps you concentrate, or do whatever helps you focus for a short while on you, because what matters most is your mental health. Before we begin, it's important to be clear that this is a general introductory course. We share broad themes and strategies that can help when it comes to understanding and improving mental health. We encourage you to think about how the ideas in this course can work for you. We acknowledge that mental health can be a sensitive subject. Reflecting on our experiences can sometimes bring up difficult thoughts and feelings, and that's normal. Be kind to yourself, go at your own pace, and take a break if you need to. If you feel you need more immediate help with your mental health and you're not sure where to go, please see the Need Help Now section of our website for details of local services who can offer support. You can find this section at www.wellbeingcollege.org.uk/resources/need-help-now. To start us off thinking about mental health, let's do a quick quiz. I invite you to note down your answers to each question as we go along. Question 1. How many people in the UK will experience a mental health challenge every year? Is it 1 in 4, 1 in 8, or 1 in 2? The answer is 1 in 4. It's quite common to experience challenges with our mental health. Question 2. Which of these is a common symptom of schizophrenia? Is it violent behaviour, split personality, or hallucinations and delusions? There is the wide belief that people with schizophrenia are likely to commit violence. Rather than being the perpetrators of violence, those with schizophrenia are in fact more likely to be the victims of violence. Also, it's a myth that people with schizophrenia have split personalities. So the answer is that the most common symptoms are in fact hallucinations, delusions, and also human voices. Question 3. What proportion of people with severe mental health challenges have been victims of a crime in the previous year? Is it 12%, 28%, or 45%? Unfortunately, it's the highest figure of 45%. Question 4. What proportion of people with mental health challenges experience stigma? Is it 90%, 10%, or 50%? Sadly, research carried out by Time to Change shows that up to 90% of people with mental health challenges experience stigma of some form, whether from friends and family, in the workplace, in education, or shockingly, even during their treatment. Question 5. How many people will experience suicidal thoughts throughout their lifetime? Is it 17%, 2%, or 33%? It's actually 17%. Question 6. Which country's Prime Minister was re-elected in 2001 after publicly taking time off for depression? Was it Mexico, Norway, or Poland? Norwegian Prime Minister Kjell Magne Bondevik announced in 1998 that he was experiencing a depressive episode and took 3 weeks of sick leave before returning to office. Jondevik said he received thousands of supportive letters. Question 7. What proportion of people with mental health challenges believe that workplace stress contributed to their illness? Is it 1 in 5, 1 in 3, or 2 in 3? Two-thirds of people with mental health challenges believe that long hours, unrealistic workloads, or bad management either caused or exacerbated their condition. Question 8. How long do the majority of people with a mental health challenge wait before telling their closest family and friends about it? Is it 2 months, over a year, or 7 months? A Time to Change survey showed that 60% of people with a mental health challenge waited over a year to tell the people closest to them about it. Now let's consider what we mean by the term mental health. Please take a few minutes to write a sentence that describes good mental health. Or if you prefer, simply note down any words or images that come to mind. Pause the video while you note down your thoughts and click play when you're ready to move on. There is probably no right or wrong answer here, and everyone who completes this course will probably say something slightly different. But here are some definitions of mental health you may find helpful. According to the mental health charity Mind, good mental health means being generally able to think, feel, and react in the ways that you need and want to live your life. The Mental Health Foundation says, if you're in good mental health, you can make the most of your potential, cope with life, play a full part in your family, workplace, community, and among friends. This quote from the World Health Organization describes mental health as a state of well-being in which an individual realizes his or her own abilities, can cope with the normal stresses of life, can work productively, and is able to make a contribution to his or her community. Note that in none of these definitions is mental health described as a mere absence of a mental illness. Much like our physical health is more than just simply not having a disease. Just as we all have physical health, we all too have mental health, and sometimes our health can be good or bad, regardless of any diagnosable illness. For some, a diagnosis of a mental health condition, or in some cases an illness, such as depression or anxiety, is helpful. For others, it doesn't fit with their experience and feels limiting or an unwanted label. For this reason, here we will tend to talk about mental health challenges within our overall mental health and emotional well-being. Many people consider mental health as a scale, with good mental health on one end and bad mental health on the other, directly linked to whether someone has a specific mental health challenge. This diagram shows the idea of a mental health continuum, linking overall mental health and well-being to the individual's experience of their mental health challenge. Starting bottom left of this diagram, we can see that on one hand, someone may have a specific mental health challenge and poor mental health. Yet on the other, someone may cope well despite mental health challenges and experience positive mental health overall. The opposite is also true. It is possible for someone with no identifiable mental health challenge to experience poorer or better mental health. That's because the factors influencing mental well-being will affect all of us, to a greater or lesser extent, at different times in our lives. Some of the feelings and experiences of people with mental health challenges are not commonly experienced, like hearing voices, for example. But many feelings and experiences are common to everyone, although experienced to an extreme degree when experiencing mental health difficulties. It is very rare that an individual fits neatly into a single definition. People's feelings and behaviours vary over time, so labelling can be inaccurate and unhelpful. As we've just seen, the factors that impact our well-being will affect all of us, so let's consider some of these factors now. Please take 5 or 10 minutes to consider all the aspects of your life that can impact your mental health. Examples might include the quality of your relationships, whether or not you are in employment, how much sleep you are getting, or how much stress you are under. Perhaps think of a time when your mental health was better or worse than it is now, and consider what made the difference. Again, please pause the video while you note down your thoughts and click play when you're ready to move on. Each of us will probably give different answers to the questions of what impacts our mental health, but there are themes we can probably all relate to. The 8 dimensions of well-being, a concept devised by Dr. Peggy Swarbrick, suggest different aspects or dimensions of our lives that contribute to our overall well-being. In no particular order, let's look at each of these. Firstly, whether or not we occupy pleasant, safe, and stimulating environments affects our well-being. Being homeless or not feeling safe at home, for example, may lead to poor mental health. Also of importance is the degree to which we feel financially secure or suffer social and economic disadvantage. Being in good physical health means we are attending to our basic needs, like eating well, taking regular exercise, and getting enough sleep. This can go a long way to promoting good mental health. Our spiritual needs refer to our sense of purpose and meaning in life. It's important for our well-being to also feel a sense of connection with others and to have a good support system. We also need to be able to express our creative abilities, find ways to expand our knowledge and skills, or generally experience the right level of intellectual stimulation. Our emotional health and how we cope with life, as well as our ability to form satisfying relationships at work, home, or as part of our social life, all impact our mental health. Relationships in which there is violence, bullying, or other abuse are likely to negatively impact our mental health. So too can feeling socially isolated or lonely. Finally, our mental health can also be influenced by whether we are in work that we find satisfying and enjoyable, whether it's paid or not. Perhaps the answers you just noted down reflect these different aspects of your life and how they contribute to your well-being. Is there anything else you may not have considered? We've thought about what affects our mental health. Now we're going to understand a bit more about poor mental health and how it can impact people. Let's consider how you would know if someone is mentally unwell. For this activity, I invite you to take a piece of paper and draw a simple outline of someone on a page, a bit like this one. Add words, phrases, or images next to the person to illustrate all the ways in which poor mental health might affect someone. What might they think? What sorts of thoughts might go through their minds? How might they feel? What emotions might they experience, or how might they feel physically? Would they feel sad or angry? Would they be more tired or have an upset stomach? What might they say and do? Would you notice any changes in their behaviour? Pause the video and press play when you've noted your ideas. Whilst every person is individual, there are some common ways in which poor mental health can affect someone's thoughts. This might include confusion, muddled thinking, difficulty concentrating, persistent negative thinking, and perhaps thoughts of suicide. Obsessive or intrusive thoughts and rumination, where thoughts go round and round in our heads with no real end point. A sign of poor mental health can also be intense or persistent versions of the normal range of emotions we all feel. It's common to feel anxious, worried, or sad from time to time, but not to the extent these feelings are continuous for weeks at a time or interfere with our day-to-day lives. Equally, if we are not feeling great emotionally, we might feel it in our bodies. We may experience physical pain such as backache, tension, stiffness, headaches, an upset stomach, low energy and tiredness, or other physical symptoms that suggest our mental health is suffering. It's also true that pain felt in the body can often affect someone's mood, which in turn inevitably has an impact on their mental health. Poor mental health may also result in changes in behaviour, such as overspending, changes in appetite, secrecy, risk-taking behaviour, poor self-care, changes to how often and what we post about on social media. We may misuse alcohol or other substances, have difficulty concentrating, see changes in sleeping patterns, become quiet or withdrawn, or irritable or moody, or generally lose interest in the things we used to enjoy. You may have noticed that not all of the thoughts, feelings, or behaviours associated with poor mental health are particularly extreme. They are not hallucinations, delusions, incoherent speech, or erratic behaviour, or perhaps even a panic attack, things that would clearly suggest someone is unwell. Rather, the signs may be more subtle and perhaps easily missed. However, many of us can probably identify with the thoughts, feelings, and behaviours we've just described, because mental health, like physical health, affects us all to one degree or another. In fact, the number of people affected by mental health challenges may be higher than we imagine. According to the Mental Health Foundation, every week in the UK, 1 in 6 adults experience a common mental health challenge, such as anxiety or depression. 1 in 5 adults has considered taking their own life at some point. Nearly half of adults think they've had a diagnosable mental health condition at some point in their life. In Scotland, mental health problems at work cost Scottish employers over £2 billion a year due to sickness absence, presenteeism, working whilst sick, and staff turnover. It also needs to be acknowledged that inequalities in society are strongly linked to mental health inequalities. Children and adults living in households in the lowest 20% income bracket in Great Britain are 2 to 3 times more likely to develop mental health challenges than those in the highest. However, it must be stressed that being at greater risk of mental health challenges doesn't mean developing them is inevitable. It's also important to note that people can and do recover. Later in the course, we'll see that there are many things we can do to support others towards positive mental health and take care of our own mental well-being too. Unfortunately, despite mental health challenges being common, there isn't always the same compassion and understanding given to mental health when compared to physical health. Whilst attitudes are changing, it's important to acknowledge stigma surrounding mental health still exists in our society, and its effects are harmful. In a moment, we'll try an exercise to illustrate this. Before we begin, please be aware that you may find this activity and the rest of the discussion about stigma upsetting, especially if stigma surrounding your mental health is something you have personally experienced. As ever, please be kind to yourself, take the course at your own pace, and if you need to, skip this activity and move on to the next slide. Otherwise, if it feels okay for you to do so, I invite you to think of all the names you have heard, read, or perhaps used yourself to describe someone with mental health challenges, even if you've just said them as a joke. For example, you may have heard the term crazy or nutcase. Pause the video while you note down any other names you can think of. There are many words or phrases, like the ones you may have written down, that people use every day without giving them a second's thought. Words like bonkers, psycho, wacko, and such like. People may not realise they are in fact hurtful and encourage discrimination. pause the video again and try the same exercise, but this time imagining someone who has a chronic heart condition or cancer. Were you able to come up with anything? Perhaps some judgments about lifestyle, if that has contributed to their condition? But in society, we have few derogatory terms for someone who suffers physically in comparison to those who suffer mentally or emotionally. We can also see how attitudes towards mental health have been influenced by the media. Whilst there is more news coverage aimed at explaining mental health problems, this is not true for all diagnoses. As a glance at some newspaper headlines can show, there is now more awareness and acceptance of challenges like depression and anxiety, which are perhaps more relatable, whilst people with other serious mental health challenges are still associated with violence. The second article states that mentally ill people are up to 10 times more likely to become a victim of crime than the average person. However, this is not apparent from the headline, which may be all that some people read. We can see from this discussion of stigma that it's not surprising people may be reluctant to talk about their mental health for fear of being judged. This is despite mental health challenges being common. That's why it's important to raise awareness about mental health and do what we can to end discrimination. Let's continue by dispelling some common mental health myths. How many of these surprise you? Myth: people with mental health challenges aren't able to work. Fact: people can have a job alongside mental health challenges. In fact, some people with very serious challenges can hold down very responsible roles. Many of us probably work alongside someone with a mental health challenge, given they are so common. Myth: all young people go through ups and downs as part of puberty. It's never anything to worry about. Whilst the ups and downs of puberty are common and not necessarily anything to worry about, sometimes they can be a sign of something more serious. 1 in 8 young people will experience a mental health challenge, so it's important to remain aware. Myth: you can't recover from mental health challenges. Fact: whilst they may not go away entirely, people with mental health challenges can and do lead full lives. Myth: I can't do anything to help someone with a mental health challenge. In a moment we'll see there are plenty of simple things you can do that can really make a difference. Let's take these last two myths and look at them more closely. First, the myth that poor mental health is something we can't recover from. The Wellbeing College supports the idea of the recovery model. Put simply, this is an approach towards mental health that recognises people can and do recover from mental health challenges, however long-term or serious they may have been. It's an approach that doesn't focus solely on symptoms, but rather on personal strengths. It emphasises building resilience and having control over life's challenges. The model asks, what can help someone move forward in life to realise their hopes for the future? Recovery is a very individual concept, and there is probably no one definition that suits everyone, but here's a definition from the Scottish Recovery Network which may be helpful. They define recovery as being able to live a meaningful and satisfying life as defined by each person in the presence or absence of symptoms. It's about having control over and input into your own life. Each individual recovery, like his or her experience of the mental health problems or illness, is a unique and deeply personal process. In other words, whilst people may or may not recover fully from a mental health challenge in the way we often can from a physical illness, they can still realise their goals and develop the relationships and skills that support living a positive life. It's therefore important that when talking about mental health, we keep recovery very much in focus. If you'd like to explore the concept of recovery further, we run a course at the college called What is Mental Health Recovery? Details of which can be found on our website. Now let's address the myth that you can't do anything to help someone with a mental health challenge. If you're concerned about the mental health of someone you know, it can be difficult to know how to respond. But remember, you don't need to be an expert in mental health to help. It doesn't matter if you don't understand what they are going through because you've never experienced something similar yourself, or that you don't know how to fix it. What matters is that you are kind and willing to help. Let's think of a person, we'll call him Tom. Lately he has been finding it harder and harder to get up in the mornings and seems very tired. He's had a few headaches. He also seems forgetful and disorganised. He forgot his flatmate's birthday for the first time in years. He's been spending a lot of time in his room. When overheard speaking with his family, he has been quite irritable and short with them. If you were his flatmate, what might you do to help? If you wish, pause the video and take a moment to note down your ideas. Here are some thoughts about supporting others. Why not ask how they are and really listen to the response? Take time to just listen and empathise. It can really help people just to have someone to talk to so that they can sort out their thoughts and feelings even without being offered solutions. Try not to judge, but imagine instead what life is like for them and how they must be feeling, even if you can't directly relate. Help as best you can. If there are other ways you can show that you care, perhaps by offering practical support like cooking a meal, then offer that. Even small things can make a big difference. Do remember to seek further support if you're concerned about someone. It's also important to make sure you don't become overwhelmed yourself. We'll let you know where to find sources of support and information at the end of this course. What about keeping yourself well? Let's think back to the 8 dimensions of well-being we looked at earlier. Why not pick one dimension and note down 3 things that help maintain your well-being when it comes to this aspect of your life? For example, under environmental, perhaps you've noticed you prefer quieter environments, or you need to have regular access to the outdoors or green spaces, or you enjoy visiting creative environments like galleries or craft fairs, for instance. Pause the video and take as much time as you need to consider this. Remember, you can revisit this slide at any time and consider what else positively impacts your well-being. We're almost at the end of the course, so let's review what we've looked at today. We've taken time to understand what mental health is and that it's something that affects us all. Recognise the signs of poor mental health. Consider the impact of stigma and discrimination surrounding mental health. Appreciate why recovery is central to any discussion of mental health. And think about how we can look after our mental health and also support the mental health of others. Perhaps as a final activity, consider what you've learned today and what you'd like to do differently as a result. Firstly, for yourself. Maybe there are 1 or 2 small changes you can make in your life that will make a big difference to your mental health. I invite you to write that down now. Now that we know mental health also affects many people around us, what 1 thing might you do differently to support others? Perhaps be a better listener, learn more about mental health, or challenge stigma. Remember, if after this course you feel you or someone you know needs additional support with their mental health, please see the Need Help Now section of our website for details of local services who may be able to help. If you would like to find out more about mental health, there are many resources out there. A good place to start is the Mind website, www.mind.org.uk. You will also find useful information on the Mental Health Foundation website. To review the Mental Health Awareness Quiz and find out more about how to tackle mental health stigma, you may wish to visit the Time to Change website. This may be the end of the course, but hopefully not the end of our time with you. Please look at our website, where you can register for more of our courses, including our self-study course, What is Mental Health Recovery? You can also contact us to request an appointment with a personal tutor to find out more about the college and perhaps to develop a personal learning plan. If you're not already on our email list, please sign up to receive our newsletter so we can stay in touch. We'd also really love your feedback on this course. We'll send you an email in a few weeks to ask you what you thought of it, so please do let us know. Thank you again for taking the time to work through this course today and for being willing to learn more about your mental health. Thank you too for being part of the Wellbeing College. We look forward to learning with you again soon.